Penguin Random House Audio presents The Big Chair, the smooth hops and bad bounces from the inside world of the acclaimed Los Angeles Dodgers general manager, by Ned Colletti with Joseph A. Reaves. This is the author, Ned Colletti. This book is dedicated to those who dream and wonder if life's dreams will ever blossom into realities, and to those who mentor, lead, and teach us dreamers, those who provide selfless opportunity and allow us to flourish and believe that all things are indeed possible. Author's note: this book is a work of memoir. It is a true story based on my best recollections of various events in my life. I recreated dialogue to match my best recollection of those exchanges. 1. The 805. When you grew up in a blue-collar neighborhood where dads labor in factories and moms measure aspirations by packed lunchboxes, dreams for a better life don't have to travel very far. For me, the journey started on the 805 morning train from Mannheim Station to Wrigley Field. I took that train and then two buses at least 100 times to sit in the bleachers and watch my beloved Chicago Cubs, never once appreciating that each trip was a divine wink of dreams in a life to come. My mind drifts back off into my boyhood days in Franklin Park, Illinois. It was an honest place to grow up, a place where you knew the mailman and the mayor, the dog catcher and the dentist. Parents worked, worried, then worked harder. Kids played baseball, went to school, then played more baseball. We played anywhere we could, in vacant lots without real bases, on the streets, and in organized leagues during the summer. We talked about the big leagues, memorized statistics of our favorite players, and dreamt of playing for the Cubs. A few even dreamt of playing for the White Sox. I thought about those carefree times as I sat alone and stared at my cell phone. I was 2,000 miles away, in Los Angeles, and the sun seemed to be shining brighter than it ever had. Back home, rain was falling. So were the leaves. Seasons were changing. Autumn was turning to winter. My wife, Gail, who I had known for 34 years since our days together at East Leyden High School, was wrapping up a shopping trip with her mother in the Chicago suburb of Elk Grove Village. Their dinner plans suddenly got canceled when I called. In Oxford, Ohio, our daughter Jenna was having an early dinner with two college girlfriends in an apartment near the campus of Miami of Ohio. Her dinner was interrupted when Gail called. At the family home in Wooddale, 15 minutes west of Franklin Park, our son Lou answered the call from Gail and got a lump in his throat. My brother Doug had left Chicago at 6 a.m. for a day-long in-and-out business trip to Houston. I reached him as he sat in a window seat on an American Airlines jet, engines turning, on the tarmac about to take off for the return trip to O'Hare International Airport. Doug was off the phone in less than a minute and hustling to make two quick calls of his own before the plane took off. The first was to his wife, Val, asking her to meet him at the curb outside O'Hare with a fresh set of clothes when he landed around 8:30 p.m. The other call was to his travel agent, who booked him on a 10 p.m. flight to Los Angeles. By the time he landed in California in the middle of the night, after traveling more than 3,700 miles in one day, he had 40 voicemails on his cell phone. Word was quickly spreading. Two of the last calls I made that day were to my mom and to my Uncle Frank. My mom was in a retirement home in the Chicago suburb of Schaumburg, struggling with the early stages of dementia. Mercifully, she was still sharp enough to savor the news. My voice cracked and I wept as we shared our feelings. Uncle Frank, my late dad's lone surviving brother, couldn't have been prouder. He broke into tears of joy before I could. Then we both wept, knowing how wonderful it would have been if only Ned Lewis Colletti Sr. could have been there to share the moment. The day Frank McCourt made me the 10th general manager in the long, proud history of the Los Angeles Dodgers, November 15th, 2005, was monumental for the Colletti family. I had just finished my 25th year in Major League Baseball, an accomplishment that was beyond my wildest dreams. And now I would be taking over one of the most storied franchises in all of sports, a bit of franchise that was reeling after its second worst season since World War II. I was 51. The age at which my dad died of lung cancer, not far from where he made a home for his wife Dolores and sons Doug and me in Franklin Park. At the age when my dad was saying goodbye, I was saying hello to one of the most prestigious positions in professional sports. Before it was over, I would get to know some of the best players and people in baseball's amazing history. I would become friends with men who I had idolized when they played. We assembled teams that won with hustle and class. I added future Hall of Famers at the trading deadline and signed some of the best of all time. Over the course of my career, I had the chance to work for three of the most fabled franchises in the game, my hometown Cubs, the San Francisco Giants, and the Dodgers. I became one of the highest-ranking executives in baseball history to work for both the Giants and the Dodgers, two longtime rivals. And for one day, that magical day in November 2005, I actually worked for both of them, officially changing from one to the other at high noon. I almost wished I'd had the chance somewhere along the line to work for the St. Louis Cardinals. Then I could say I worked both sides at two greatest rivalries in the history of the National League, the Cubs and Cardinals in the Midwest and the New York, California Dodgers and Giants. Almost. Then again, it would have been bittersweet to work for the Cardinals. They were the team I disliked most growing up, and the way my career unfolded, I disliked them even more as time went on. Over the years, I dined with Sinatra and Scully, and got to drink into the wee small hours of the morning with Santo, Carey, and Brickhouse, and a long parade of wordsmiths, some extremely talented and some not so much, who earned their livings the way I began my career, writing about sports. I saw the World Series up close and personal and sat helplessly as the teams I helped put together stumbled in the postseason, the worst possible time. Former commissioner, the late A. Bartlett Giamatti, said it best, "Baseball breaks your heart. It is designed to break your heart." While my career unfolded, I was blessed to raise a loving family and have two children who graduated from great universities with advanced degrees. I began my life living in a Chicago garage and ended up with a place besides the Pacific Ocean and another in the Arizona desert. For more than three decades, I attended an average of 225 baseball games a year. I traveled throughout the United States, Canada, and Latin America watching men and boys play baseball. I saw the Great Wall of China and the breathtaking harbor of Sydney, Australia, thanks to baseball. I spent more than a calendar year of my life in New York City, the same for St. Louis, Montreal, Denver, San Diego, and other National League outposts, all accumulated in 3 to 4 day increments, and all the while I called Chicago, San Francisco, and Los Angeles my home. I stayed in some of the best hotels. I knew bellhops, shoeshine men, restaurant servers, and receptionists by name. I watched cities change in the shadow of new baseball stadiums. I saw buildings come out of the ground, highways laid down, and said hello and goodbye to more than 1,000 players. I learned to tell time by hearing the Montreal Gazette hit the floor outside my hotel room at 3:30 a.m. or by the honking of horns on the street below the Grand Hyatt in Manhattan. I watched baseball played by young people on high school and college fields, in minor league parks with dim lighting and outfield walls cluttered with gaudy advertising. All of us, even though we were generations apart, sharing the same dreams that revolved around the big leagues. I traveled to Latin America in airplanes that were 40 years old to see youngsters work out on dirt fields cut into jungles, where players used milk cartons for gloves and sticks for bats, and cattle, chickens, and dogs roamed the outfield. I scouted players in politically precarious Puerto La Cruz, Venezuela, on a cricket pitch in Australia, and in a makeshift stadium in Beijing that was built and torn down with Potemkin-like chicanery by the Chinese government to placate Major League Baseball and the International Olympic Committee. Along the way, I had the honor to watch the best of the best play in Wrigley Field, before and after lights. Wrigley Field is where my dad took me to my first baseball game in 1961, and where my favorite team played. Wrigley Field is where my baseball career began. From there, I went on to see every Major League stadium any team has called home since 1982. I worked alongside nearly 24 Hall of Famers and went to more than 100 World Series games and 20 All-Star games. For me, the pinnacle, the reward for a quarter century of tireless work, time away from my family, and 4 a.m. landings came that fall day. During the next 9 seasons, the Dodgers would go to the playoffs 5 times. In my 11th season as an executive in L.A., the team went to the postseason 7 times. We'd come within 2 wins of the World Series twice and within 3 wins twice. Our 5 postseason appearances matched the best 9-year run in Dodgers history, as did the 7 playoff appearances in 11 years. I inherited a team that was staggeringly bad, and with the baseball operations staff, turned it into a perennial winner that rekindles the Dodger brand and set attendance and revenue records. It wasn't always easy. We also had some historically difficult times. On my watch, the franchise and its fans endured one of the most challenging ownership eras in American sport. We survived, though, and somehow even managed to thrive. From 2006 through 2014, no general manager won as many games nor maneuvered around more landmines, all under the white-hot spotlight of the second-largest market in Major League Baseball. Through ownership turmoil and public relations firestorms, I had a chance to use what I learned on the gritty streets of Franklin Park, from the wise men and women who were fortunate enough to finish high school and earn an hourly wage. Franklin Park was settled in the 1890s. Decades later, it became a hub for industry, thanks in large part to the trains that rattled our house. In 1942, Franklin Park was the fourth largest industrial city in the state of Illinois. It was blue-collar. People of Franklin Park were tough and strong. People of different cultures supported one another in a time when that wasn't always the case. The lessons I learned from watching and listening on street corners and porches with the wise guys and hustlers of Franklin Park were put to the test time and again during my days as general manager of the Dodgers. From time to
time. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.